Yeah, thank you, Amelia, for the nice introduction. And yeah, hello and also welcome from my side to our today's webinar about supercapacitors. Just maybe one more word about myself. I'm also responsible for the product services in for capacitor and resistor, means also application support for design in and measurement details about the products. So if you have any questions relating or regarding the capacitors and also our current sensor resistors, don't hesitate to ask me also besides this webinar. But today we will have an overview about how we can keep the balance for the supercapacitors, and there are quite a few techniques available, and we will go through it. But first, we will see or have a look at the agenda. So we will start with a short roundup about the supercapacitors, also like their classification, their model, and also charge discharge behavior. And after this, we will answer questions like why we have the balancing or why we have to do it, why is it important, and how we can realize it. And at the end of this presentation, we will have a look at our practical examples of the complete balancing. So as I said, let us start just with the roundup and the classification of the supercapacitors, that you know about what kind of products we are talking about. So supercapacitor is a kind of generic term, and it's a different of three technologies. The most used one is the electromechanical double-layer capacitor. This is also known as the EDLC, followed by the pseudocapacitor. And then there's also some hybrid capacitors available in the market. The difference for the technology makes the design of the electrodes. So this is really special for each kind of product. And for supercapacitor edible electronic, we use activated carbon as an electrode material. Yeah, now what makes the supercapacitors super? So the charging and discharging possibilities for these products are unique. You can charge and discharge them very fast, and also we have a long life cycle with around 500,000 cycles. And in addition, the power output is around 10 times higher than a battery, especially a lithium-ion battery. But of course, there's also some limitations of the technology. This is the low energy capacity. It's around 30 times lower. And also it has or the supercapacitors have their linear voltage dependency when you draw energy out of it, and compared also to an traditional capacitors, it's quite the same, but the power output of the supercapacitor is much bigger, but also the rated voltage of the traditional capacitors is higher available voltages. The main parameter for an energy storage device are charging and discharging times, as well as the power and energy capacity. Especially, or for example, the rated voltage defines the output power, and so this is here the output power, and the voltage is limited, especially for the EDLCs, by an electrochemistry, so-called decomposition voltage. And especially for non-aqueous electrolyte, this is around 2 or go up to 3 volt. Then the capacitance defines, of course, the energy storage, what is possible. It's also in the equation here above. We need also this equation later. The ESR defines the maximum power output, and the isolation resistance defines the charge storing capability, also the so-called self discharge. Well, these are the main parameter for the performance of the supercapacitor. If we are now going to compare the charge and discharge behavior of the supercapacitors with the behavior of a battery, in general, we see one point that the current of the EDLCs are higher than for batteries. But of course, we have also the voltage drop, and the voltage drops also constant with the current as a linear with time. Since the physics don't change, then it's still capacitance, also when it's called super. That means I can charge and discharge the supercapacitor very fast, but I have a voltage drop due to the ESR when I start to discharge the capacitor, and then it falls further in a linear way. Yeah, battery in comparison has almost a constant cell voltage and also current with the current operation. And yeah, just for you a hint, we have a so-called support node, and please have a look for more information about the charge and discharge behavior for our supercapacitors. Then all supercapacitors are measured and available in our online tool with Expert. So you can have a look at the impedance, the ESR, and also the maintain voltage can be looked up here. And this is a really interesting thing to know. Depending on how long the supercapacitor was charged, and the discharge is slower or faster. So with this maintain voltage over time here. And we have measurements available for 8 hours, 24 hours, and 72 hours of pre-charge time. So you can have a look up here in our online tool. Yeah, as I said, it was just a short roundup about the supercapacitors that you know about, a really short way about the technology. And now we will have a more detailed look at the balancing itself. So why we do the effort of balancing and how we can set it up in our applications. Furthermore, we will have a look at our practical examples. Yeah. But however, before we go into the topic, we have to answer one question, and the question is why we connect supercapacitors in series. In general, there are different possibility or two possibilities to connect the capacitors. So you connect it in, you can connect it in parallel or in series. And as I said before, the good thing is the physics stay the same. So in parallel, we increase the capacitance while the voltage stays the same. And in series, the capacitance drops, but the voltage of this new created block, let me say it this way, of the two capacitor increases. And when we want to know the amount of energy, what is available in such a system, this is described with the well-known energy formula, what I also showed before. There you can calculate the energy, what is inside the system. And yeah, the overall energy stays the same. It doesn't matter how we connect the supercapacitors, but we increase the possible applicable voltage with this series connection. So when you compare parallel here and series, in series you increase the rated voltage, but the capacitance go down. Here capacitance go up, voltage stays the same, but the amount of energy, yeah, is, as I said, the same. Yeah, if we connect the two supercapacitors in series, we have to consider one important thing. We have to be sure that the voltage over one single cell single cell stays below or at least equal to its rated voltage. This is why we have to do the balancing. Of course, we use real parts, so we have to deal with the tolerances and the production variance of the supercapacitors. This means the leakage current can be different, and this leads to also a different self-discharge. While the overall voltage, so the overall leakage current of the application, of course, stays the same, but the leakage current from the two supercapacitor cells can change. Yeah, therefore, the capacitance, ESR, and the leakage current will be different. Of course, this has no influence in a steady state balance, but it can may create a different thermal condition when we have fast charge and discharge cycles. And due to the fact that the components change over time, the disbalance also change over time. And when you want to know more about the aging, please have a look at our webinar. We backup your application. There's more details about the aging behavior. Yeah, now we connect our two supercapacitors in series. And if we use the full tolerance range, we have to deal with minus 10 and plus 30% of initial capacitance. And therefore, we get 9 farad or 13 farad, and we buy a 10 farad supercapacitor. Yeah, more capacitance sounds very good in the first look. But because of the tolerance and the higher capacitance, we have to do the balancing. Especially, oder ja, was heißt, when we charge the block to its rated voltage of the 5.4 volt, we get a voltage difference of about 0.5 volt. And this is our largest possible disbalance. Yeah. And when we assume that we want to balance this voltage within 1 second, would be really fast, we can calculate the current. So the current can be calculated with Kirchhoff's junction rule, and we consider the currents that flow out of the junction as negative, and the currents that flow into the junction as positive. And since both currents flow out of the junction, and the balancing current flows into the junction, the balancing current will be around 11 amp in sum. Also the result of current depends on the voltage differences and also on the balancing time. This means when we increase the balancing time, the balancing current respectively goes down. So this is just an example that we use to have a good calculation. And we say, okay, we do it within 1 second. As a brief overview, we can distinguish between passive or active balancing of the charges. So passive is used if operated primarily under DC condition. It has a low cost and also slow balancing and has respectively high losses. Active balancing used if the application often charge and discharge. It has a higher cost, fast balancing, and low losses. For the passive balancing, if you lower the resistance value, especially with the resistance balancing, you get a faster balancing, and the internal resistance of the supercapacitor mainly governs the disbalance under the DC condition, and we have the disbalance under AC, so under charge and discharge condition, is mainly governed by the capacitance value. And now we go more in details. But yeah, before we go, one hint about the examples. Please be aware that these are laboratory examples, and they are completely exaggerated. You will see we have a really big difference, but of course the difference will be lower in real life. But when you mix different vendors and different parts and different ages, there will be a specific difference. But please keep in mind, this was a laboratory example to show the balancing. So what we did, what did we do? Actually, we choose two different parts. So we have one part is a 15 farad type, and one is a 10 farad type. So we choose two different capacitors, so article numbers. Please see, you can see them here, and also this associated measurement. Also, what is now available in the tool is the capacitance over temperature. So you see here on the right side, capacitance change over temperature. And yeah, so there are some reasons behind why we choose it, choose two different parts. Firstly, this setup provides a significant and reproducible disbalance of around 0.5 volt. We could change the set of capacitors without an intensive search for suitable mismatches. Secondly, it also demonstrates the potential robustness of the supercapacitors if operated under extreme overvoltages. Also, the lifetime drastically reduced to a few weeks with the calculations. None of the used supercapacitor shows a catastrophic failure, and at least it shows the operation of the different balancing strategies under extreme conditions. As I said, in practice, the variation of the capacitance is much lower than in this example, even over different production batches. Yeah, the distinction between passive and active may also change depending on how you speak, but our declaration is as follows. For the passive balancing, we use the resistors, Zener diodes, and MOSFETs. And for the active balancing, we use an operational amplifier and a special DC-DC converter, which is dedicated to charge, discharge, and balance supercapacitors. So this would be our distinction between those two possibilities. And I would like to start with the passive balancing. So when you have a look at a schematic here, the red and green arrows in the picture, they represent the physical current flow for the case where C1 has either over or under voltage, and the balancing resistors adjust the current for the balancing speed, and the resistance should be as low as possible to allow fast balancing. This will be beneficial for lifetime too. And the resistance should be as high as possible to minimize losses and minimize the self-discharge. One word about the accuracy of the resistor or the shunt. It should be sufficient in order to provide an accurate reference. And we recommend in a range of smaller equal than 1%. Yeah, clearly it's necessary to find an optimum between short balancing time and low self-discharge. And the balancing resistance would have to be in the order of the equivalent zero resistance to balance a supercapacitor within the characteristic RC time. But this is, of course, a theoretical consideration and not practical, since it would mean we permanently short circuit the supercapacitor. Here, a good rule of thumb is 1/10 of the insulation resistance as a resistance value. And so therefore the balancing resistors are the same value. The balancing current is the same for both cells, and the leakage current could be also negligible. So, and also the balancing with the resistor is the most used balancing method, as we know. And also one additional information here, when you have supercapacitors with a voltage rating of 5 volt or 5.4 volt, they are often two cells in series with parallel resistors, so they adjust in one package. But to show you more information about the balancing of the system and also of the self-discharge, we created for each example two diagrams. So one is the time-dependent cell voltage on the left side, and one is the measured self-discharge diagram for a period of 24 hours on the right side. For the self-discharge, we disconnect the entire balancing circuit from the primary power source, and after the capacitor were fully charged and also balanced. And then based on these measurements, we also give an assessment about the applicability of the circuit in a standalone long-term application. This is more or less in for several days. So for the passive balancing, we used an 1 kilo ohm, 0.6 watt resistance. We have chosen the resistance in favor of a short balancing time rather than a low power loss. But the 1 kilo ohm is a very low resistance value. The measured voltages here on the left side. So the measured voltages V1 and V2, and the resulting voltage difference show a complete balancing after around 600 minutes. So it's the green cycle. So the red curve, when you see also in the other diagrams, is the, let me say the balancing voltage. So the voltage difference between the cells. The purple one is the rated voltage, the charge voltage what we have. And the other things are the rated voltage of the cell and also the voltage at the different capacitors, to the 10 farad and 15 farad types. Yeah, the V1 and V2 approach the rated voltage asymptotically, and for low power application or for backup solutions, this balancing speed may be sufficient, fast, and the power loss is also acceptable. But for battery-driven standalone applications, the resistance increase the resistance to reduce the loss. Also, to be on a safe side, it's also advisable to reduce the operating voltages to avoid real over voltages. And the result of the self-discharge measurement is, we call it a half-life self-discharge time. So we have a look when the cell is half discharged, is around 113 minutes. So it's the green bar here. So you see the cross point. Here's the voltage, charge voltage, and also the voltage difference, also in red. So when this hits the 2.7 volt, this is our half-life self-discharge time, and it's about 113 minutes. Needs the system to be discharged to half the voltage. So, an improved balancing time achieved if the resistors replaced by Zener diodes. So here, also again, the schematic with the green and red arrows, they again indicates the electrical current. And the Zener diode constitutes a variable resistors or voltage-dependent switched resistors. And since the internal resistance reduced at a breakdown voltage, it's possible drastically reduce the balancing time in comparison to the linear resistor. Also, diodes may serve as general protection against reverse polarity, especially when you think about larger stacks. It can be advisable to place Zener diodes in parallel to a MOSFET, for example. The accuracy of the breakdown voltage is compared to the accuracy of an ohmic resistor usually relatively low. In total, tolerances can be up to 10%. Possible overvoltages avoided also by reduction of working voltage. And also when you think about higher temperatures in your application, it may also be necessary to consider the shift of the breakdown voltage due to the temperature coefficient of the Zener diode. And the strong voltage dependence of the reverse current was the reason it was really difficult to calculate a balancing time. But the actual current characteristic of commercial Zener diodes was really hard to find in the data sheet. For our example, we used the diodes BZX79 from NXP, and the results indicates a complete balancing around 80 minutes. And with the datasheet value of the total power dissipation of around 500 milliwatt, the measured value fits roughly to our theoretical approximation of 70 minutes. So this fits quite well. And due to the strong nonlinear voltage dependence of the Zener diodes, we estimate that the datasheet value of the dissipation current in our case was 10 times higher. And when we have a look at the result of the self-discharge measurement, it shows that we have around 1,900 minutes as a half-life self-discharge time. So yeah, please note that the diagram is logarithmic here. So we have here our 2,000 minutes line, and we are really hitting it with the 1,900 minute. So we have a really long discharge or self-discharge time here. Another type, what we can do is balancing with a MOSFET. It's quite similar to the Zener diodes. The MOSFET is a voltage-driven switch or variable resistor in our case. Also, we do here the schematic with the respectively arrows. which indicates the electrical current flow. And it's quite similar to the passive balancing. And as soon as the voltage disbalance exceeds the threshold voltage of the MOSFET, the increased drain voltage leads effectively to a discharge of the overcharge capacitor. And it's possible to think of the MOSFET as a voltage-dependent resistor, which leads to improved balancing times compared to the just really passive resistor. The MOSFET-based balancing circuit implemented with the test board from advanced linear devices. And please note that these MOSFETs are specially built for the supercapacitor balancing. These are no standard transistors. They have really fine-tuned gate threshold for a certain desired supercapacitor voltage. So please keep this in mind. So here's the concrete article number of the MOSFETs we used. And what we see here, the results indicates a complete balancing around 300 minutes. And the overall power loss after 12 hours was 8 milliwatt, were really low, also compared to the set diode. The results of the self-discharge measurement show that after 24 hours, the cell voltage has decreased to about 4 volt. With this rate, the discharge will be in the order of several days. Therefore, of course, we conclude the circuit is suitable for long-term standalone application with really a high half-life self-discharge. Any application that needs a shorter balancing time will have to apply an active balancing. Active balancing always involves integrated circuits such as op amps, and the circuit contains also here the red and green arrows, which represent the corresponding currents. The balancing resistance as used for the active balancing, so this one, is determined on the basis of the designated internal resistance of the op amp, which is at least in the order of 10 mega ohm, but usually even higher. And to ensure that the voltage detection at the inputs, the balancing resistance should be around 10 times, also here with 10 times smaller than the internal resistance of the op amp. And as a result, the loss through the balancing resistance can be as small as for the internal resistance of the supercapacitor. However, a more significant cause of loss is the supply current. Depending of the type of op amp, the permanent supply current may be in the range of 1 microamp to 10 milliamp, or it depends what you have. The balancing current provided by the output of these op amp and regulated via the feedback loop, and the damping resistance at the output of the op amp is only as high as to prevent oscillation during the current regulation. For the active balancing, we used an op amp from Texas Instruments, the OPA 2677. The advantage of this op amp was the relatively high output current with around 500 milliamp, which enables us a fast balancing. And the measured cell voltages show an instantaneous balancing within the charging time, which is in the measurement about 3 minutes. So just 3 minutes of the complete balancing. And here you see also where during the charge is also the balancing happening. The speed of the balancing can be further increased by decreasing the damping resistor. So we did it from 1 ohm to 0.5 ohm. And with the 0.4 ohm, the balancing time is around 2 minutes. But the trade-off is noticeable. We had some evanescence oscillating, so you have to be aware of it. And the damping resistor at output should, in our case, not below 0.4 ohm to prevent this oscillation. In our case, 1 ohm is an optimum between fast balancing and damping, and the overall power dissipation after the 12 hour is around 270 milliwatt, and the power mainly dissipated via the supply terminals of the amplifier. So at the end, this type of strategy is fast, but it also has a large permanent power burn. And when we have a look at half-life shelf, discharge, self-discharge, we see that it takes just around 5 minutes to decrease the voltage to 2.7 volt. And I think you agree that we do not consider the circuit suitable for long-term standalone application. But when it's every time powered, then of course it also provides a fast balancing solution. Yeah, another concept of active charge equalization consists of DC-DC converters. So each connected across the neighboring cell, and due to the losses of the low losses of the available converters in the market, the concept is in terms of balancing time and also power burn more efficient than the passive balancing, of course. And there are balanced buck boost supercapacitor charger available on the market, which are suitable for a range of application. Available are, for instance, some LTC 3341 51, for example. They also have hot swap functionality, or also an LTC 3128, for example. It's in charge and balancer, balancing IC from analog devices. And there are also, of course, other parts from other vendors available, but these were the parts we had at hand. Yeah, but also the DC-DC converters, they are quite or relatively costly balancing strategy, but they are on the other side also an elaborate and comprehensive solution. They provide a complete charging and, for example, also hot swappable solution with low power consumption. And it's like always the choice is at the end always with the engineers, what they are forced to use in terms of pricing and so on and performance. When we have a look at the results of our test with the balancing board, we have this special evaluation board to utilize the buck boost supercapacitor charger. It charges the supercapacitors to a preset voltage of just 4.2 volt. The board operates at a supply voltage of 5.5 volt. And what we see in the measurement results indicates complete balancing after 1.5 minute. So it's the fastest balancing. And the measurement results of the self-discharge shows that after 24 hours, the cell voltage has decreased from 4.2 volt to about 3.4 volt. With this rate, the discharge will be in order of several days. So the supercapacitor charger, of course, is also suitable for a long time standalone application. So you can use it also when there's a longer time, no power available. Yeah, coming to the end and also to the conclusion of the information provided in this webinar. In the following, in the above, we tested the different balancing circuit based on the balancing speed and also from the power dissipation. Also, we had a look at the pricing. Yeah, it's, however, as I said, in the responsibility of the developer to find the best solution. There are some more parameters what we have to check. Also, the availability, lifetime, and the design in time influenced the choice of the strategy. But in the end, the balancing board certainly provides the fastest balancing compared to all tested strategies. It is generally an overall convenient, but somewhat pricey solution. Concerning the included DC-DC conversion, it's an overall cost considered as moderate, what we said. Due to its low power dissipation, it might be also suitable for long-term standalone application. The operational amplifier has also fast balancing too, but shows also the largest power dissipation. And due to the high power dissipation, it's mainly suitable for standalone application. The balancing with the resistor is the slowest balancing strategy, but yields to an advantage of low power consumption as a low cost and easy circuit design. And as I said, it's in our point of view, the most used balancing strategy. Also, depending what kind of resistors you are using, it might be also suitable for long-term standalone application. The balancing speed of the set diode is moderate. It yields to an advantage of relatively low power consumption, low cost, and easy circuit design. And because of the low power dissipation, it makes also suitable for long-term application. The MOSFETs we see also have a relatively low power dissipation. Its balancing speed of our given example is moderate. And so this is why we said MOSFETs might be not suitable for really long-term standalone application. And for your reference, we made this small table here. And when you get the presentation, you can have a look at it and also our conclusion. So, please also for your reference, our different resources, what we have about our supercapacitor topic. We have certain webinars and certain videos in English. Also some documentation. So as I said, we have some support note, how to use the supercapacitors, also an application note for the complete design in process. And we are also working currently of a balancing app note where we describe everything, making the calculations, and so that you have also later on a document where everything is described and you can have a look at it. Also, it's always worth to step by of our Red Expert. There are a lot of data available, and also, of course, online catalog. You get samples and so on. So please step by. And now, I already see that there are some questions popping up. So please give me a few minutes to read, and then I will answer hopefully all of your questions. So first questions, are there any supercapacitor management systems eval boards? So of course, from the IC manufacturers, there are a lot of available. it doesn't matter if it's TI or analog or also different vendors. But from our side, we are also working on a eval board, but it will take some time to set it up, to bring it to sales. But when you are interested, please contact me or my colleague Amelia, and we can share some information. Next question would be, is there a self-discharge in supercapacitors? Yes, of course. For example, when this is also the graph what I showed with this maintain voltage. So depending how long the supercapacitors are pre-charged, the charge will stay longer or less longer. for example, it's released maybe days. So supercapacitors are not suitable for replacing a battery for long-term energy storage. Then, how did you get a 0.5 volt difference? Yes, that's a good point. I did not put it in the presentation because it's a long equation and calculation. But please share your contact details with Amelia, and I'm happy to provide the math behind. So we have it. It's there. but it comes from the capacitance values and how you calculate it with the charges. And but we have it. It's not a big deal. How we calculate the set impedance versus frequency and how we calculate the ESR versus frequency. The good thing is it's not a calculation, it's measured in our lab. So we have all measurement equipment available and we can measure it. So it's not no calculation, it's a measurement. So next question is really good. If the balancing is generating such a complex architecture, isn't it better to have multiple supercaps in parallel and then a booster to generate the desired voltage? In other words, which application would require balancing with supercaps? So one thing is what I said, that some manufacturer provides, for example, 5-volt supercapacitors, and they are just two cells in one package with a parallel resistor for balancing. So you could not integrate an DC-DC converter inside the supercapacitors. It would not be that the cost would be extremely high. And also, for example, when I want to have 12 volt, I just connect the four supercapacitors or the five supercapacitors in a row, put one resistor parallel to each one, and then that's it. And I have 12 volts, so I don't have to do an DC-DC converter, which some boost converter. I need an inductor, I need also capacitor, and so on. So it maybe gets also complex. Of course, you have to calculate the time, the balancing time, and self-discharge, and so on. But I think for the most application, or also when you do some backup application, it's worth to think about the balancing instead of using just the booster and do the paralleling, because there's also the cutoff voltage. So it's, you have then, when you just put them in parallel, you have 2.7 volt, and you have to find a booster which operates really to a low cutoff voltage, that you have a big range to get the energy. Yeah, it's every time depends what you want to do. Next question, do you provide the layout files for your boards? No. But when you are interested in how we did it, please contact us and we can exchange. But as I said also in the presentation, these are laboratory examples, and we do it really in a really drastic way to show the differences. Next question was, what happens during rapid discharge with the various balancing schemes? Is it the same as the charging phase? We have some power dissipation, but the most current we get out from the supercapacitors, because the internal resistance is lower than the ESR, I don't mean the insulation resistance, I mean the ESR, and the ESR is much lower than the resistance of all balancing schemes. So when you have a really fast discharge, it comes all from the supercapacitors, and there should not be a problem with the supercapacitors. Then one question is, what are the practical implications of slow balancing time? So of course, when you have a fast balancing, it's always better, because then the disbalance or the overvoltage cannot cause any failure to the supercapacitor. But we show also that when you have a slow balancing time, it's also good in some way, and when you have this passive balancing with a resistor, then you can do this slow balancing. But yeah, fast balancing time is always what, or is something what we want to desire. And the last question what I have here is, how do you estimate the current capability of the balancing circuit based on the charge super capacitor current and discharge load current? Honestly, I don't get it in the right way, so I'm at the moment I cannot answer it, but I think Amelia can send me the contact details and I will get in contact with you afterwards. Sorry for that. Yeah, so that was all questions at the moment. Thanks for stepping by, for listening. And yeah, so thanks and wish you a nice week.
Thank you very much, Frank, and thank you for joining us for today's Worth Electronic webinar powered by DigiKey Electronics. Now, if your question was not answered during the presentation, or if you think of them at a later time, please email us at here4u@we-online.com. That's here4u@we-online.com. Don't forget to register for our next webinar coming up on February 16th. Designing SiC MOSFET gate driver systems using the new WE-AGDT transformer series. Register online at we-online.com/webinars.